boys and girls, men and women, non-conformers and non-believers, gender X and gender equals, Dasher, Dancer, Prancer, Vixen, Comet, Cupid, Donner, Blitzen and Rudolph. Welcome to the special Christmas episode of Eat the Storms, the poetry podcast. My name is Damien B Donnelly and I am the host and producer of this show, and I am especially delighted to welcome you to this now annual event full of festive fanfare and folly. It has been a week of Christmas celebrations here at Eat the Storms. Last Tuesday was the live Zoom show Deck the Storms, where I was joined by 19 poets from around the world, including Canada, America, New Zealand, Ireland, England, Scotland and Wales, for what was truly an evening of exceptional talent, and not to mention some fantastic festive jumpers. I myself went as a reindeer, and for the moment you can catch up with that show on YouTube if you look up Deck the Storms. Now, today on the show, I am truly honoured to introduce you to 15 guest stars who are bringing the very best of winter and Christmas themed poetry, prose, fiddle playing, and yes, from me once again you'll get some unaccompanied singing, but I've given you fair warning. So what more is there to say other than I hope you enjoy the show. I'm going to start off the show today with a poem that appeared in Sarah Connor's Advent Poetry Calendar earlier this month. This is a poem about a Christmas I spent in Paris when I was actually living in London. Some friends of mine from New Zealand and myself decided to head off to Paris as it was one of the only cities open on the 25th. I persuaded my mother to drop everything, including family and fanfare, and come with us. For weeks beforehand, myself and my friend Megan tried to find a place that was perfect for eight of us to stay. In the end, we found a converted shoe factory with indoor balconies and jacuzzis on the foothills of Montmartre. We spent Christmas Eve at midnight mass by the Sacre Coeur, lit only by nuns holding candles, and when we came out, we found a tiny bar, still open, that housed a piano, a pianist and a female singer with a feather boa and bowls of French onion soup. Christmas Day followed with a meal at the exceptional Le Tremblay restaurant, even if getting there proved a little bit difficult because I was convinced it was in Gare de l'Est, as I used to live in Paris, but it turned out when we got to Gare de l'Est that it was actually in Gare de Lyon. My mum at the time was in a gypsy skirt which she sailed and twirled through the Champs-Élysées and the Palais de l'Élysée in. This poem is called For Auld Lang Syne. Montmartre after midnight, in the very depth of winter, under the host in her core in candlelight, as black boa feathers teased keys on pianos and bowls of French onion soup. In a gypsy skirt, she twirled her midlife around the 25th. Familiar threads of childhood, like the first snows falling, decorate steps of the Elysee. Moments are thus sealed, making mangers into magic. On a market morning, pre-feasting, stuffing red noses into picks of ripe pineapples, in gloved hands, icicles thought to be trees. In Le Tron, of many more colours than just blue. Chefs at side tables flambé Suzette till sugar runs liquid across the station tongue of Lyon that I'd mistaken to be less. Snowflakes catching flight on the staircases of interior courtyards with its Romeos on balconies and holly berries trailing in a former factory. Aotearoa on the periphery of Paris, gifting out parcels to Lusk girl, no longer local. Montmartre after midnight, child born to be king, and we under the giggle of cocktail whisper au revoir to new friends found as snow melts. Never the same flake, flame, moment. We cannot go back, and equally, we can never let go. Up first on this special Christmas episode of Eat the Storms today, we have a returning guest whose debut poetry collection, The Kitchen Sink Chronicles, was published by the Hedgehog Poetry Press in January 2021. A former advertising copywriter, editor and accounts manager before becoming a full-time mum to four children and now with a focus on creative writing since her children have grown up, her work has been placed in various international competitions including the Plough Prize, Poetry on the Lake, the Magic Oxygen Literary Prize and the Welsh Poetry Competition. She is an actor and director for the Newport Playgoer Society and the Everyman Theatre Cardiff. With a full collection coming in 2022 from the Hedgehog Poetry Press called Tea and Toast, this is Adele Cordner.
Hello, Damien and listeners. I'm delighted to be back on this wonderful poetry podcast to share some winter poetry with you. My first poem is about Christmas from the perspective of a very important yet often neglected piece of crockery, the turkey platter. This is a year in the life of the turkey platter. Afterwards, they load the dishwasher, search for after-dinner mints, make coffee as the tallest returns me to the dresser top. For weeks, I eye the roasting tin, loaded with drumsticks, small fowl, beef, lamb joints, chops. The cake dome beneath me comes out for every birthday, stands a centrepiece for days on end. When the chill leaves the air, I host the birth of spiderlings, hold dying flies in my expansive middle. One day, sun warms my corner, and the big Pyrex goes out, crammed with burgers, sausages, kebabs. The salad bowl is layered with a vegetable rainbow, and I wonder if I will ever feel a breeze on the raised flowers round my rim. I knew that I was precious from the time they moulded me from clay, from the time I was lifted from the kiln, glazed with a soft brush. "Be careful," a man said to another. "Don't drop this one like you did the last." As days get shorter, my excitement builds. The tree comes in. They string lights across the dresser, use my weight to hold the end. The big bird arrives in its box. Next day, they take me down, anoint me with perfumed liquid, cleanse me of cobwebs, dust, insects, warm me in water, dry me with a clean towel, pile me high with turkey, potatoes, stuffing, pigs in blankets. At last, I am presented to the steaming table. The family let out a cheer, pop crackers. I bask in candlelight, given pride of place alongside silver servers. They all rush to see me. For an hour, maybe half, I am treated like a star. My next poem is set on a snowy day, and it explores themes of transience. A Fall of Snow. In all the excitement of wrapping ourselves in hats, gloves, scarves, of seeing our boots print clean snow, of tasting flakes that fell on our lips, hearing our coats thud with snowballs, waving our arms into outstretched angels, sledging down the bank and rolling, rolling, laughing, rolling, then trudging home as the light grew grey and our clothes grew heavy. We forgot to tuck his plush bat safely in a pocket. Amidst the wails, our eyes met. We looked back at the melting scene and knew that it was lost. For my last poem, I'd like to take you back to last winter, at the height of the pandemic, when we had a few power cuts here in rural Wales. This is Power Cut in a Pandemic. The dark descends. We hunt for candles by the light of mobiles, finish cooking dinner on the gas hob, leave washing up heaped in the shadows, huddle around hissing logs. The kids want to play a game. We leave them to it, weary of the whole mess of things. Later, I wake, nudge my husband. Listen, listen to that. Not loud music or a buzzing TV. Not the hum of fridge or freezer, nor a whirring dishwasher. Not clanging heating pipes, nor a throbbing tumble dryer. But a sound we haven't heard for weeks, months even. It lifts floorboards, rattles windows, shakes cobwebs, sweeps dust from beams. Laughter, the laughter of the young in the dark. Thank you so much, Damien. Merry Christmas, everyone.
If you joined us last Tuesday night for the Zoom show Deck the Storms, an evening of poetry, prose and friends, then you will be well aware of my next guest and her musical talents. If not, then please feel free after the podcast to head on over to YouTube and look up Deck the Storms, where for the moment you can see a recording of Tuesday night's event. She is a singer and songwriter, a fiddle player, an occasional violin player, as you will see on the YouTube video, and a poet, based in Kildare, where she is currently working on her first EP and a poetry collection. Today, sharing her poetry and the fantastic musical strings on her bow, this is the exceptional Mairead Carroll.
Hello everyone, I hope that you're all keeping safe and well as we approach Christmas. I would love to share a poem that I wrote called Snow is Fleeting, followed by a tune on my fiddle, Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas. The snow is fleeting across time and space between you and I, becoming more whole in its spitting silently, unsure of its place between land and sky, gathering strength amidst the chaos of longing. Carried swiftly by the east wind, it sweeps across the miles, fallen and hidden in masked smiles, meeting tears that sit softly unnoticed underneath chins, like a pool of water held with cotton, dropping at feet walking a lonely road. The flakiness of the fallen snow melts into the grey concrete. Though welcomed by the thirsty robin, the transformation of tears and sleet into snow. Children's eyes widen, that the flakes hug and join together to form a blanket of snow across their gardens. It is time for magic, time for play and fun, and making snowmen, throwing snowballs, and to be in the moment, as children so effortlessly do. Without cares of it being too cold, their laughter and smiles, making happy memories, is a joy to behold.
Next up on this special episode, I'm delighted to welcome back another familiar guest from the United Kingdom. His work has appeared in many journals, including Flight of the Dragonfly, The Daily Drunk Mag, Dark Poets Club, and recently he took third place at the micro poetry competition held by Black Bough Poetry. He is currently finalising his chapbook based on his youth, and until December the 24th he will be releasing a new haiku on his website as an alternative advent calendar that should not be missed. I am delighted to welcome back to Eat the Storms, a poet influenced by landscape, history, culture and the working class heritage of Newcastle upon Tyne. This is the always excellent Paul Adam Short.
Ho ho ho, yippee-ki-yay, and Merry Christmas, everyone. Thanks for having me back, Damien. I really appreciate it. Today I've got four festive poems to share with you all. Not all of these have been published as of yet on Paul Wright's Poems, but will be in the near future as we get closer to Christmas. The first poem that I'll be reading to you today is called Home. I felt at home in Copenhagen at winter's twilight. Under the glow of warm vintage lanterns, our breath visible through knitted woolen scarves. The air was kissed with the scents of cinnamon, clove and citrus. The nearby sounds of mirth and merriment interspersed with delighted roars and screams from the roller coasters above us. Warmth came from holding your hand and the chewy crunch of sweet spiced almonds, while opulent flakes of diamond snow fell graciously, each one lining our pathway, already a vivid spectrum of technicolour from Tivoli. We sat on plastic and pine stools, dropping krona into the palm of a Great Dane, and laughed with love as we tried to make wooden horses gallop to the end of a straight line, taking our time, appreciating life as it's meant to be, together. That's why I feel at home in Copenhagen, because I'm always there, with you. So the next poem that I'm going to be reading is called Firebird. Last night the sky was black velvet, flecked with scattered diamonds, and the snowdrop moon that shone over frozen earth. The winter wind was biting, but we were warm with hot chocolates, big coats, and knitted headbands. The world felt almost monochrome at -2, until the robin landed on the gatepost, ruby chest pushed out, flames dancing in its eyes. A firebird. This next poem takes me back to my childhood and is called Christmas Holiday Daredevils. The snow fell softly, silently, blanketing the town before daybreak. It was deep enough to sledge in and lose a boot. Out the window, a march had already begun, street kids trailing sledges and inner tubes from tractor tyres, up towards the golf course and their hills. The walk took us past the hedgerows, showing the families already there, a dad and daughter skimming down on a black bin liner, and some of the older lads on an old car bonnet spinning every which way. At the entrance, scrambling over a stile, I was ready to tackle a hill, dodging bodies to reach the top and the quick queue, quicker than I'd ever seen. It was tradition to share the first trip down with my brother. He handled the steering as we sped in the bullet straight line all the way to the bottom. So we went again and again and again, together and apart, until my final solo descent, which was head first, full of fear and peer pressure. I almost made it until I ate a wedge of snow, hurting my arm in the process, and one of the car bonnet boys had to pull me out the way as the dad and daughter sped by my feet, that black bin liner tearing to shreds. It left my brother to trail the sledge as we laughed all the way home, full of childhood adrenaline, Arctic air, and Christmas Eve's snow. And finally, this poem is called The Calm of Boxing Day Morning. Holding hands in fresh gloves, we walk the winter woods. It's quiet on Boxing Day morning, probably too many bad heads still slipping it off. The essence of Christmas hangs in cool air from the pine sentries lining our route, watching us, and the scarves wrapped around our faces, the same scarves that muffle our voices and the words that we get wrong, singing those Christmas songs that everybody knows. We ask each other to name their favourite part of Christmas so far. I say, spending quality time with you. And I know I've said it every year, but it's the truth, and you say the same. I get lost in your hazelnut eyes when the snow begins to fall, and I wonder what it would be like to be frozen in time, right here, right now, in this moment. But when the snowflake hits my cheek, I wake up from my festive fog, and we walk on together, forever. Our destination unknown. Well, thanks a lot. I'd just like to hope that everybody has a very Merry Christmas from myself, and that you all have plenty of chocolates and drinks or whatever it is that you have to celebrate the festive period. Merry Christmas.
Another very popular guest returning now to Eat the Storms, who was with us recently reading poems from her Broken Sleep pamphlet, which came out as a part of their Legitimate Snack series called The Tricolour Textbook. She is currently doing an MA in Oxford Brookes in creative writing and has appeared in Northern Gravy, Atrium, Dalmatian, Dear Reader and Poetry Wales. Today, she joins us for a fantastic fresh look at this period of Christmas. This is a former cabin crew, now flying solo as poet, Wendy Allen.
Hi, I'm Wendy Allen. Thank you, Damien, for inviting me to read on this Eat the Storms Christmas special podcast. To celebrate and to get into the festive spirit, I'm reading these poems in my favourite leopard fur coat, the same as Kate in Last Christmas, one of my absolute favourite Christmas films. When Damien asked me to do this podcast, I thought about how I could incorporate Christmas into the themes which are so important to me, that of menstruation, sex and the body. My friend Ed suggested that I call this The Festive Period as a working title, and that leads me perfectly into my first poem. Menstrual Cycle Advent Calendar. Day 1. On the first day I get my period, the window steams from the heat of my menstrual cup boiling in this Christmas scene. I mark the date with a star on the calendar. I open the Advent door. I bleed some more. 2, 3, 4. Day 5. I am light as snow now. My menstrual cup discarded like the carrot from a snowman's nose as it melts from the heat of my use only for boiling menstrual cup pan. 6, 7, 8, 9. Day 10. I'm hungry for you now. I want you in corduroy, the wool of your Christmas jumper wet as you go down on me. 11, 12, 13. Day 14. I'm light-haired, my dress pretty, and I'm hot-scented. The picture inside today is mildly pornographic. If you open me up, you'd find a nativity-style star inside my left ovary, which hurts in the way ovulation sounds on my tongue. 15, 16, 17, 18. Day 19, I want you urgently. The 19th door made of cardboard is stuck shut, swollen like my breasts. It will reopen in 2.5 weeks. 20, 21, 22, 23. Day 24, I bleed early. There are 2 starts on my bleeding chart, 24 days apart. I have 1 chocolate left, which I stuff into my mouth to compensate for the fact that inside I am empty. I wanted these poems to be sort of like a Love Actually kind of sequence. I wanted them to be linked by their Christmas theme, but also by the other side of Christmas, the fact that during this period we have a lovely time. We distract ourselves by drinking pumpkin spice lattes, wearing knee-high bobbled socks, but often our relationships are struggling during this period and come under scrutiny. So I wanted to sort of link these two things and bring the sad part of it into the Christmas realm. In Copenhagen, my next poem, I wanted it to sort of be the Joni Mitchell part of Love Actually, about love that just is on the turn, love that isn't actually working. Copenhagen, on BA822, I'm 27A, you 27B, an algebraic equation for this shade of I love you, my vulva pressing down onto a seated denim crest. At the hotel reception, your hand on my hip, it is 12:15 and I love you. The first lie, fucking under a May night sky disguised as midday. I'm mottled skin, the colour of I love you, fingers rubbed over September eyes where you find the ridge between sand dune and liquid. In room 203, I'm 1,000 times I love you. Your platinum band hides between my thighs from the December Tivoli lights outside. My my next poem was written when I went to Larne 2 weeks ago to visit Dylan Thomas's boathouse. Larne. I drink tea that tastes of December, a stewed red fever spread by polystyrene cup, thickened estuary in my mouth, heat in hips in this part of cervix. I bite a crescent into the foam edge, leave lipstick moans on the rim which crack like shivers on impact with my teeth. I am dancing frantically the night before this in a skirt the colour of 2:45 in the bathroom ceramic. Morning is cusping, almost. I want you to pull out my menstrual cup and lick off the white kiss. You are stiff like waking in January. My next poem, I wanted to talk about the tradition of bringing down the decorations and how sometimes that can take an unexpected turn. You tell me as we are putting up the Christmas tree, we have just taken the box down from the loft, the hatch barely covered over. For 18 Christmases we have done this, and now you calmly tell me it is over. We continue to assemble parts, manipulating fake branches into rusty parts. There is a 10-minute look for a missing part. There's no point. We are over. There are 6 snowmen from garden centres, a fairy from long before I met you. There's a train which seems to be in a hurry to depart. We are off. We are over. The bauble I hold in my hand is a robin, as red-breasted as I am pale-faced. I put it on the edge of the branch where it nosedives, knowing its journey is over. We put the tinsel on last, like legs wrapped around each other, expose sparse the pretty bits on the floor, like the sex we no longer share. Like us, it is over. And my final poem is a poem that is inspired by Wendy Cope. I was lucky enough to do a workshop with Dr. Rosie Miles. We looked at This Christmas Life by Wendy Cope and then wrote some poems inspired about that. So thank you very much for that, Rosie. After Wendy Cope, bring in a card that you've written so I can remember what your writing looks like as I taste the tips of your fingers. Bring in a list, a bath bomb of cinnamon that leaves a rim around the inside of the bath the shape of I've missed you. Bring in the aroma of tagine, rainy afternoon, windows open, a packet of apricots toppled over, staining the worktop the colour of holiday. Bring in the smell of you on bed sheets, the aftershave layered on my rose petal discharge on the sheet below. Bring in the hope of this image, the intercontinental in a room overlooking the ice rink in Vienna, as I pull on orange knee-high socks and tell you I love you. And thank you, Damien, for inviting me to this podcast. And finally, thank you for listening and to have a lovely Christmas.
For our next festive guest on the show today, we are heading over to London for a poet who's been published in various journals, including Ink, Sweat and Tears, London Grip, Atrium, Rigwalter and Envoy. His first collection of poetry was published in 2016 by Listen Softly London Press, called Being With Me Will Help You Learn. And in 2020, his poetry collection Grenade Genie was published by Fly in the Wall Press. A familiar performer at many London events, including Celine's Salon, The Quiet Compere, and Birkbeck Writers' Room, I'm delighted to welcome back to Eat the Storms, Thomas McCall.
Hello, Damien. Thank you very much for having me on the Eat the Storms podcast once again. Season's greetings to you, and season's greetings to everyone who's listening. I'm going to be reading 4 poems, 4 Christmas-themed poems. The one I'm going to start with is one that's taken from my current collection, Grenade Genie, which was published by Flying the Wall Press and was published last year in 2020. And the poem I'm going to read, it's a poem about shopping. And of course, Christmas and shopping go hand in hand. And this poem is called Jackpot. It's time to do the Christmas shopping. And here I am at Oxford Circus Station once again, allowing myself to be part of the human jackpot that's released each time a train pulls in. I don't know if anyone else ever thinks this, but whenever I'm on a train that's entering this station, and I'm watching the branded posters on the platform wall whiz past my carriage window, I'm reminded of playing a slot machine. Okay, this one has a single horizontal spinning drum instead of the usual vertical three, but it's not like the odds are stacked any more in my favour. The train's come to a stop, and my carriage window reveals a mixed line, Gap Kids, Nike Air, and the Oxford Circus Roundel sign. Whatever the combination, though, I'll never win. It's Oxford Street that always wins the prize, with today being no exception. The carriage empties, and every other carriage is emptying too, as shoppers flow like coins from every exit of the train. What else can we do at this stop, when we've all been programmed since birth to have nothing else but shopping on the brain? And the next two poems I'm going to read are poems from my first collection, Being With Me Will Help You Learn, which was published by Listen Softly London Press back in 2016. And the first of these two short poems that I'm going to read is, the first one references Midnight Mass, which is very much a Christmas tradition. And it's about me in my teenage years. So it's from back then, and it's a poem called Kelly. At midnight mass, the priest bearing down on us with the Virgin Mary and the Sacred Heart, from his pulpit was too high up to see, Kelly sat beside me, stroked my leg, bring her hand around the inside of my thigh. He talked of heaven while I thought of earth, for now my racing heart was no more sacred, as my virgin eyes enjoyed the sight inside my mind of Kelly totally naked. And the other poem I'm going to read from this collection is, it's one, I do write a lot of poems that feature London and different places in London, and this particular poem mentions London and also Christmas Day, so obviously got to read this one. And it's a poem called The Chalk Fairy. Each night I traipse the streets of London, drawing chalk lines round homeless people sleeping rough. I found that even in the early hours of Christmas Day, there's no shortage of bodies to draw my outlines round. London's one big crime scene every single day of the year. And the final poem I'm going to read is a more recent poem, so a poem that's in neither of my two collections. And it's about, well, families, and Christmas is about families, and as you know, it isn't always happy families, as this poem will attest to, and the poem is called Guess Which Hand. Guess which hand, said Dad, as he held out two large fists, and going on a still unpleasant gut feeling, I chose the fist which yesterday had punched me at the dinner table, giving it a gentle slap. And this time, instead of charging me like a rhinoceros, it opened up like an oyster shell, its hard exterior usually clasped tight, revealing now its soft interior, at the centre of which was a one-pound pearl. For a moment I simply gawped at the coin that looked as if it was held in place by a pair of pincers, Dad's lifeline and heartline, two lines that were much more dark and distinct than mine, and which continued to grip this one-pound prize despite the palm having opened up. Go on, take it, said Dad. So I snatched the pound as deftly as a plover snatching a morsel of food from between a crocodile's open jaws. Hard experience had taught me to always be cautious. These jaws that defined Dad's life and heart, and for now remained wide open, were prone at any moment to snap shut tight and do some serious harm. Today, though, Dad was in a buoyant mood. It looked likely I'd get through today unscathed, but tomorrow, well, who could say? A punch or a pound, I could never be sure which way it was going to go. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you again, Damien, for having me on your podcast. And happy Christmas to you all, and have a great new year. And all the best for the coming year. Cheers. Thanks a lot. Bye.
As I've mentioned on previous episodes, this year I got the immense delight and joy of being sub-editor along with M.S. Evans, who's going to appear later on in the show today on Christmas and Winter Edition Volume 2, which was published recently by Black Bow Poetry. So a huge thank you to Matthew M.C. Smith for the opportunity. Matthew will be with us later on in the show today. One of my poems which appeared in this collection is called I Don't Tell Anyone I Do This. But I don't tell anyone I do this, but I hold something back every year. After a burial, boxes returned to attic's dust, their sparkle now shadow. I hold something back from distance. Something so small, a simple thing, like I held your scent, the caress of your palm on my chest, your breath on my skin when you were my being. I hold something back every year. An odd ornament to pull out from the jacket of January, to remind me that we're circular, that snow falls but the sun melts. I hold something back every year. After the burial, something simple, to recall how we once hung holly with hope. It's coming on Christmas, cutting down trees, putting up reindeer and singing songs and joy and peace. Oh, I wish I had a river I could skate away on. It don't snow here, staying pretty green. Gonna make a lot of money, then I'm gonna quit this crazy scene. Well, I wish I had a river I could skate away on. Wish I had a river so long I would teach my feet to fly. Oh, I wish I had a river I could skate away on. I made my baby cry. Another poem now that I was delighted to have published in Christmas and Winter Edition Volume 2 from Black Bow is called Some Dreams Are Designed to Delude. I decorate this tree with aging ornaments, designed to return me to a past perfection that never performed. I draw snowflakes to delight these pages, yet never discerned their detail in the palm of my own hand. Some nights slip beyond all explanation. empty stockings over sleepy heads, daring checks behind closed eyes before morning delivers the light. Some things are designed to delude. I hold spray before chopped tree, and without a single cloud, snow falls indoors. Joining us now for the first time on Eat the Storms is an artist who I have had the immense pleasure of being sub-editor with on the latest anthology to come out of Black Bough Poetry, Christmas and Winter Edition, Volume 2. Not only was she the sub-editor, she also curated the soundtrack of the poems from this collection, currently available to listen to on SoundCloud. Aside from editing and curating, she is an exceptional Pushcart-nominated poet and visual artist, originally from Seattle, currently residing in Butte, Montana. With work appearing in Ice Flow Press, Black Bough Poetry, Green Ink, Anti-Heroin Cheek, and Fevers of the Mind. Taking a moment away from working on her first book, I am delighted to hand you over to the exceptional M.S. Evans.
Snow Comes by M.S. Evans. Snow comes like a hunter hidden. It stalks the woods on long legs. A god of old we greeted in the ancient language, lichen and stag. An equalizer. Snow caresses trees, stone walls, smooths earth scars with light. Five Thousand Feet by M.S. Evans. The air gasps, leaves behind snow's essence, iridescence. It dresses the wind, breathless.
Next up on the show today for this Christmas episode, we have a first-time guest, and I am delighted to welcome her. Having heard her read now twice at the International Page and Stage events, organised by Gordon Hewitt of the Monthly Magazine in Northern Ireland in connection with the Community Arts Project. She is a writer and an artist from Warren Point in Northern Ireland and has been studying and writing short-form poetry for over a decade, including haiku, haibun and tanka, with work featured in various international journals. The haibun that you are going to hear her read right now is called Timeslip and was first published in the journal Drifting Sounds and most recently performed at the aforementioned International Page and Stage event from Opposite Corners of the Earth. A haibun is a short form of poetry originating in Japan that combines prose and haiku. This is the mesmerizing Marion Clark.
Timeslip. I stop walking in order to shift the weight of my rucksack further up my back. Although at its weakest, the winter sun provides a welcome warmth to my upturned face. I continue along the path, following the icy cloud of my breath down the slope, treading carefully for fear of losing my footing at this final stage of the journey. When I reach the ditch, my stick pierces the gleaming crust that has formed on a snowdrift. It crunches underfoot, creaking as my boots sink into the icy layer. For a moment, I want to look back, to survey my tracks, just to be sure. But I shake my head and set off down the lane. Midnight Mass. Flickering candlelight on holly berries. Finally, I arrive at the first house of the village, and a sense of nostalgia sweeps over me. A hint of cinnamon in the air announces that it is almost Christmas. A young boy on the street just ahead is a dark-haired version of me at that age, complete with school satchel and woolly hat. It looks like he too is heading back to his house for a bowl of his mama's chicken soup with its warm promise of meatballs and dumplings. My mouth waters and I realise that this is a real aroma that accompanies me home. The clock tower in the square confirms that it is lunchtime, and the anticipation of hot food in my belly drives me onwards through the village. I see pain. A stranger prepares a meal in Mama's kitchen.
Next up today on Eat the Storms, we have a poet whose debut collection, Falling Slowly, was published by Book Hub Publishing in November of this year. No stranger to being published in journals, online and in print, she's appeared in Black Bough Poetry's Deep Time Volume 1, Pandemic.ie, Pink Plastic House Journal, Paragraph Planet, and was one of the featured poets in I Am a Poet Wave 3 in 2020. Today, while reading some of her poems from her collection Falling Slowly, she will be joined by fellow poet and editor of Nightingale and Sparrow, Marcel Newbold, who read with me at the live Christmas show last Tuesday called Deck the Storms, which is now available to rewatch on YouTube. Also joining her today will be Mark Anthony Owen, author of Suburbia and curator of I Am Poet, who will read In the Scattering of Tongues, Beckethian Women in Four Acts, which was featured in Trice Fiction Volume 2 last December and is now having its first anniversary. Joining us from Switzerland, this is Amantine Brodeur.
Hi Damien. Thank you so much for the lovely invitation to join your wonderful galaxy of guests. Hi everyone, I am Amantine Brodeur and I live in a small lakeside town in Switzerland. I'll be sharing readings from two very different bodies of work. The first is my new chapbook collection, Falling Slowly, from Book Hub Publishing, Ireland, which came out in November. And the second is In the Scattering of Tongues, Beckettian Women in Four Acts. The first poem I'm reading from Falling Slowly is titled, Home is My Forgotten Place. Did transparency take flight or inhale the interior of my first burial? Or perhaps the entire sordid story might sting without a word spoken, with dancers released like ballerina moths over sad graves. Those hidden rooms stitched into water quilts beneath the cobbled terraces of Rome and the broken outcome of my quiet parable. All those summers stacked in that decade room, unchanged amid so much alteration. This nocturnal conversationalist who breathes more font than air. How to love a storm, a bite of lightning, and bulbous vowels of nostalgia rewound in an embrace of bird bones and vehement fidelities, leaving songs behind in that lukewarm kissing. Blood dry mouth, I run rings around this living space, breathing the half light of lyrical books, settled back into third floor armchairs and candid punctuation. Funny how we shed attention only after someone dies or leaves. The second poem I'm reading is titled Girls Made of Cake. No longer potted blooms of florists accomplished in the art of arrangement or an obsession of water, nor the spindly legs of poems, they have moved on from the emotional melt of daddy rituals into the feed of the blue lotus stem, sanguine and rich, vibrant and decorative, cut to size for a lapel buttonhole, a tight squeeze for contemplating independence. For house husbandries, curated in a PDF file, layering becomes the archival anomaly, sweetness of languid honey and eager fingertips. Cut her or them short and sweet to the crispy underlay of crumble, and in that permission of play, not yet exploration, invite the girls their mothers once were, from their domestic basins and their tidal divides, back into the tender mix, way back, when skies never left their lengthy hair, and felt impelled to embrace youthful eye candy, its flavoursome crafting of girlhood, into the wistful mouthing of buttercream fondant or dark ganache. Marcel Newbold, edited Falling Slowly with exceptional care and acumen, and here she reads Schoolbook.
Hello, Marcel Newbold here, and I'm delighted to be reading a poem from Amantine's new gathered poems collection, Falling Slowly. Schoolbook. School me in the book of you, along bench rows, rooms filled to brimming along the line of track and field, brick walled by the holler to attention. Would you hold the cane to the meanderings of my mind, or will I chat with the chill breeze of corridor time out, nicked of absent-minded affections? School me in the book of you, choose the currency of your typography, leave me lost or have me found between the chapter and verse or the slide rule of your misdemeanour. Thumb me to the edges to make of me an easy fall to the open page of discovery. Invent me in a collective noun let loose, spilled into the wood of crofts or past imperfect. Dust the covering of my reckoning, field our grammatical errors in sidebars and pencil me to the margin, to remind the future there was once an imperative to your pages.
Mark Anthony Owen, the one who literally kicked off my publishing journey when the first lockdown in 2020 kicked in, reads Act One, Threshold of White, from In the Scattering of Tongues, which I wrote on December 22, 2019, not realizing it was the 30th anniversary of Samuel Beckett's passing. The work was featured in Thrice Fiction, published by Robert Spryzak in December 2020, this being December 2021, the first anniversary of its publication and the 32nd anniversary of Beckett's passing. I'm very appreciative to Damien of the chance to share an excerpt of this work with you. So here is Act One, Threshold of White, from In the Scattering of Tongues, Beckettian Women in Four Acts, read by Mark Anthony Owen.
In the Scattering of Tongues, Act One, Threshold of White. Famished and forgetful, singing songs of the dead, this rendering, mournful reversal in the death of invisible things, of body offerings, sage and lime, salted at the rim. These are our sniper tales, reimagined spells, untwining voodoo, like ancient herbalists reading the old forest floor. I read your sunburnt prose of sage and wishbones, of bird flights across Samaria by fowls having to crawl for wings glued together. There is nothing to mourn there, to hear there still in the fleeing and in departures of staying. Heartbeats crack the ceiling of the sky suddenly. The rain has a fear of falling. There's a colour of dusk that falls at the curfew of love, amber in its distillation of taste and desire for immortality. Reckless notation, emptying us of our usual, recognizable objects. In the pavilion of beauty, we throng to the celebration of our gaze. Playtime story is a sparse game in the witch hunts of kiss and tell. This hold of white has no rules of engagement, none of that surgical precision of satire, to lose one's body in Morse code possibility of its illusion, of such a thing as its future. Blindly ground by such flaws of scavengers and the deboning of poems served in burnt fig leaves, we leave seeds displaced into countries, experts in desalination and waste, flowers paralyzed by all that erroneous smoke, scraping thorns from the insides of cheekbones, blood dreams open to anything but rapture in the monotony of joy, pickled hearts in saran wrap lovage, the seasoning of foreign fish in their mysterious hush. In the paucity, but not for long, your bluer scarce stare before them deep, namely the fullness of the great, and its unchanging calm blooms, deepest meaning, deep love of mournful blasphemy, wide eyes unfelt forever waiting to take hold, librettist of bodies.
My next guest on Eat the Storms today on this special Christmas episode is a bard who has put beauty into the last two Christmases with his anthologies from Black Bough Poetry, Christmas and Winter Edition, Volume 1 and 2. Yes, this is the editor of Black Bough himself, a Best of the Net nominated poet with work everywhere from the Broken Spine Artists Collective to Anti-Heroin Chic, Baron Magazine, The Lonely Crowd and Seventh Quarry Press. His Black Bough Press anthologies Deep Time Volume 1 and 2, inspired by Robert McFarlane's Underground, have both hit the top of Amazon's poetry charts, which were followed on by Dark Confessions and Freedom Rapture, two more anthologies inspired by Jim Morrison, and as I said most recently, the Christmas and Winter Edition Volume 2. All available to buy now on Amazon, along with his own collection, Origins 21 Poems. Joining us today, this is the incomparable Matthew M.C. Smith.
Hi Damien, it's Matthew M.C. Smith here. I just want to say congratulations for all of your poetry successes this year. And also thank you. Thank you for showcasing so many poets on your podcast. And also for helping out on the Black Bough Christmas and Winter anthology. Thank you also for this opportunity to read some poems. Visitation, Mary Lloyd, by Matthew M.C. Smith. Horror, a hoarse skull. Bargain its bygone breath with death. The shock and shake of shell flays the air with its ribbon trail. Flails, tails, natters, rattles against glass, thumps, clunks, doors ajar, stealing heat to Slate Sheen Street. It reels mocking Hugh's eyes, and now skin twists out the old tongue. The mare's stare stuns a mortal's grimace. It lays bare a man to his knees, scything. He staggers, siding, sliding out from the hollow white skull, tearing down. The crazed stars are its crown. The skull careers, leers to fears, deaths, dance in time's town. Draw it back into its sack. Dumb it down to its dark. Another bargain breath exhaled. Beacons, by Matthew M.C. Smith. Figures bright on the ice-white moor, slope bound to the wilderness, ink of voices dyeing the snow. a clatter of sledges, riot of children and barking. Small fingers point to the winding wing, conducting its shadow. It vanishes over Verglas Peak, its cry as cold as frost stone.
Next up today on Eat the Storms, we have a poet who for the past few years has been adding extra light and sparkle to Christmas with her poetry advent calendar. And I'm delighted to say that both last year and this year, I have had a poem embraced here and it could not have had a better home. She lives in Devon, England, but her poetry has travelled widely thanks to journals including Black Bough Poetry, Handcraft Tub, Unspoiled Magazine and One Hand Clapping. She is a yearly swimmer, tends to her orchard and a regular host of diverse poets. With her own blog at WordPress, where she has long been one of my favourite muses, I give you the light of this season and all seasons, Sarah Connor.
Hi Damien, happy Christmas. Thank you for a year of being bloody poetic and helping everybody else to be bloody poetic as well. And thank you so much for inviting me to be on your Christmas special. Christmas Angel by Sarah Connor. Next door's angel has gone up again, her spread wings flapping silently all night. I wake and see her, keeping her vigil, as if love, not light, flowed through her veins. How brave she is, out in the cold and dark, bearing witness to her midnight hopes. The Spice Drawer by Sarah Connor. This drawer is full of magic. I have witchcraft stored here, tangled in the twisting scents of nutmeg and vanilla, waiting to be stirred into life with my long spoon, all the colours of the desert, and a slow line of camels making their way westward. And I have dreams too, dreams that crunch through the snow, sugar underfoot, dreams that pirouette across the table, dreams of gingerbread and the fresh scent of pine trees. And memories, these warm memories, fresh from the oven, the scent of cloves on Sunday mornings, the smell of cinnamon, crisped with sugar, a street bazaar that scatters cumin and coriander through the morning air, the hot taste of chai as the mist rises and the first train pulls in. This drawer is full of magic, waiting to be set free. Fox's Christmas Dinner by Sarah Connor. All we saw at first was a glint of russet, flickering behind the criss-cross, scritch-scratch winter hedge. A vixen, sniffing her way down the hedgeline, hungering. Later, we went out to look, found her prints deep and dainty in the snow, followed them down towards our neighbour's house, lost them in a flurry, a fistful of feathers and a red stain darkening the snow. Picked them up again then, a long diagonal arching up towards the top corner. Pheasant feathers, if you're wondering. Hard to begrudge.
This is my winter song to you. The storm is coming soon and it rolls in from the sea. My voice and beacon in the night, my words will be your light and carry you to me. Is love life? Is love life? Is love? They say that things just cannot grow beneath the winter snow, or so I've been told. They say we're buried far, just like a distant star, and simply cannot hold his love life, his love life, his love life. This is my winter song. December never felt so wrong, 'cause you're not where you belong. Inside my arms. Bum 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 bum. I still believe in summer days. The seasons always change, and life will find a way. I'll be your harvester of light, and send it out tonight so we can start again. His love life, his love life, his love life. This is my winter song. December never felt so wrong, 'cause you're not where you belong. Inside my arms. This is my winter song to you. The storm is coming soon. It rolls in from the sea. My love, a beacon in the night. My words will be your light to carry you to me.
These next two poems are both on the theme of frozen. This first poem is called The Thaw. Blue is the breath. Blue is the earth, morning early. The sky a clean canvas of white, and the earth blue. A bed of frozen blues born from the dawn's breath. A blanket of freshly fallen slow snow, trembling along the hairs of this land, caught in the calm before the crunch, before the footprints mold into mud all that is now a myriad of mystery. There is beauty in blue. There can be beauty in being broken, in time being frozen, in the breath baying. I twist and tremble between these sheets, still fresh upon these old shadows, still crisp over drying skin. I twist and tremble through this season to be unsure, falling into blue, into time, time that is frozen, along with all that is born in this bed, a blanket of fallen things, some things I thought to be more, some things I hoped to be less, like loss, less loss, less time, less breath, more blue. The mystery is already molding into mud. Blue is the breath, and slow, soft as the early morning snow, so slow. Awaiting nothing more than the affirmation
of an approaching melt. And this second poem was very graciously featured by Sarah Connor in her Advent Poetry Calendar last year. And this year, the absolutely wonderful Miss Yerum, Anique Yerum, read this during her series on Twitter where she reads other people's poems. This is called The Great Thaw. We fidget on settled sofas, tired of our tissue. Blankets beckon in the hot press, but we're not cold enough, not yet compressed. The seasons turned, though not quite enough. A man in shorts yesterday, in the graveyard, not even shivering on the freshly turned, since repressed earth. We talk of fairy lights, smaller tables, less chairs needed, more lights, candlelight, lights that need batteries, lights that will never light again. We fidget on the sofa, push hands down the sides, looking for all the things we can no longer find. Mom hasn't seen Frozen yet, maybe this year, to feel numb, conceal for a time, not to feel, to let it go, let it melt away as we fidget on the sofa with our tissue. Next year, we'll build that snowman again, maybe. After the Great Thaw. I am very grateful that today on this very special episode of the Poetry Podcast, I am surrounded by many returning guests, and this next guest is one of them. Originally born in Scotland before moving to the United States, where they got a PhD from the University of Louisiana and worked for the Florida State University as director of the Reading, Writing Center and Digital Studio before moving back to the United States earlier this year. Their first chapbook was called Breakfast for the Birds, which came out in 2017, followed on by We Know Each Other by Our Wounds, their first full collection published by Animal Heart Press. They have been widely published in journals including the Cortland Review, Cherry Tree, The One magazine, and with a winning micropoem in Winter and Christmas Edition Volume 2 from Black Bough Poetry, which you're about to hear them read. This is the bloody brilliant Pushcart Prize nominated poet, Jude Marr.
Hello, Damie, and everyone listening. I'm so glad to be joining you all again for this wintry edition of the podcast. I have two winter poems. I guess you could say that these are my fire and my ice. The first one is a very short poem, which appears in the current edition of Black Bough, the winter edition. This is At the Wood Stove, 100 seconds to midnight. I turn this log as the year turns. Smoke-darkened hardwood crumbles to ash. Red underbelly glowers. An ember cracks, not yet dead. The next poem, the ice poem, appears in my chapbook, Breakfast for the Birds, which came out a few years ago. If anyone has that, I should warn you that I've given the poem a new title since then. It's now called Before the Tree Falls. Winter, bone cold, creeps in between the stitches of my coat. At my throat, a hand, my hand, but barely a pulse, blood stiff between bitter fingers. I'm not abandoned, only overcast by branches. How I stand, I can't tell. Snow, my exoskeleton, flurries spit in my face. I am blinded by flakes. A star explodes. All I know, a punctured sky, a pit below. Thank you for listening. I wish for you all everything that you wish for yourselves, for the holidays, and for the year ahead.
Next up on this Christmas episode of Eat the Storms today is a guest who hardly needs an introduction, as she is a welcome returning guest and will be returning again in 2022 when her debut pamphlet In the Jitterfritz of Neon is published by the Hedgehog Poetry Press on the 20th of January. I might also add here that I am the co-author of this poetry pamphlet and could not be happier to be in such a bloody perfect poetic partnership. She lives in Dublin and works in health and social care and has had work appearing in various journals including Dreek, Abridged, the Sony Thursday Book, the Bangor Literary Journal Ink, Sweat and Tears and Algebra of Owls, and was selected for the Stinging Fly Summer School in 2019. This is my dear friend and co-author Eileen Dupuer.
Hello everyone, it's lovely to be back on the Eat the Storms podcast with Damien and the other poets. The first poem I've chosen to read today was recently published in the Daedalus Press Local Wonders Anthology, edited by Pat Boren. And while it's not technically a Christmas poem, it is dedicated to an old friend of mine who I'm very grateful to and for, and so I think it fits with the general tone of this time of year. Back at the End of the World, for Barbara. This is how you came to an unnamed spit of dunes and winter-flooded fields. The caravan park was too crowded that summer. Your mother couldn't stand it. So your father drove out, turned off, picked a field, made an offer. Clay puddles up in copper pools where we trudge now through marram trails, carved by long-scrapped dune buggies kept up by horses. Dogs, the children of the children. At the sedge break to the waves, CP and Holly catch the pebbled sky, cast back blues to the wheeling terns who dive for fish to bring back to their island mates. We dive our feet into the coarse grain sand, choose old songs on our phones, sing along to the terns, to our mothers. The second poem I have to read, Snow Globe, was published by Abridged earlier this year, and I've chosen it really because it's a little bit white and wintry in its imagery. Snow Globe. Cues come from real life now. Days start to the yawn of lunchboxes and end to dishes steeping in a soup of flotsam crumbs. Music comes from ice crusts scaling freezer walls, the thirsty gulp of gushing drains, the maudlin whine of the dryer drum. Poems whisper from the mixer tap, the lists on fine print packets, the care tags of our tumbled clothes. Plaster crack and cobweb seed to the balm of jug and butter dish. Fevered wrists find porcelain tile, glide the slopes of bathtub sides. Rubber gloves that chafed before, slip on with a velvet purr. Silken moth smuts on the double glazing, the only residue of the shaking. Finally, finally, I have an actual Christmas poem, which Matthew Smith from Blackbow Press has kindly included in this year's Christmas and Winter Anthology. Thank you, Matthew. Christmas Visitors. On quiet December nights, when ice creaks in nightcap glasses, the mist and absent gather, swirl an inch above the floorboards, swathe the deepest layers of the tree, hover in the waver of low fire embers. Evading form and shadow, they trick fairy lights, dodge candle flicker, seep away through air bricks and up the chimney breast, leave the loved and present sleeping. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Damien. Happy Christmas.
When I was a kid at Christmas, we had a crib that was underneath the tree that had all the ornaments and attendees in that crib, except for the baby Jesus. There was a cradle in the crib and it had a little spike on it. And we had a baby Jesus that was kept in a drawer until Christmas morning. And then on Christmas morning, we were supposed to grab the baby Jesus and put him onto the spike, nestle him down into this crib, and the manger was set up. Very often it was a couple of days later when we realised that we'd forgotten to pop the baby Jesus into the crib. This poem, which was published just this month in issue 10 of the Famidan Journal, Yuletide Musings, is called We Kept You in a Drawer. We kept you in a drawer and forgot about you most years. Like mashed potato mom once left in the pot. No room on the plates after the boiled, baked and chipped. The Father, Son and His Holy Spirit. Pretty boy. Baby in plastic. A hole pierced in his back for a waiting spike under a blanket in a crib we pushed him into. When we finally remembered, after eating and drinking and singing of old acquaintances, forgotten. Funny, for someone to design a tiny bed with a single spike, for a baby born to be a crucified king. Funny. The things you don't think of at the time. Like potatoes in pots that no one really missed. This poem is called Belief. Everything stops when snow falls. Even sound is muted. Ears muffed under fine fur, even wolves would envy. Everything mends under snow falls. Hearts healed, single stitched back into one solitary hole below falling flake. Everything settles after snow falls. Kings into cribs, Santa into sleigh, kids into curious past, into almost parted. Everything stops when snow falls. The bullying, breaking, losing, lying. Everything stops, so belief can begin again.
Well,
Last year, for our first Eat the Storms Christmas special episode, a guest came onto the show who enriched all our Christmases with her reading. And at that point, I realised that if this was to become an annual event, then her reading must also be an annual event. Back then, she mesmerised us with two readings, the first a poem from Louis MacNeice and the second an excerpt from James Joyce's The Dead. This year, I cannot tell you how excited I am that she is back with us, no longer reading a piece from somebody else, but reading her own prose piece, which was published this year in the Christmas and Winter Edition Volume 2 from Black Bow Poetry. Called Little Crosses Part 1, this is the second time this year that Black Bow has published her work, having previously appeared in its Jim Morrison anthology Freedom Rapture with an extraordinary prose piece called Day Trip to New Grange with My Grandmother When I Was a Little Girl. She is a Dubliner who is mad about the arts, wild about nature, and besotted with poetry reading and boosting poets on social media, which she does with all of her heart. Christmas at Eat the Storms will just be cold and gloomy without the radiant star that is our beloved Rona Green.
Hello everybody, happy Christmas. Na lachona yiv galair, na dalach chlauen, and Merry Kiri Himete Fanu. This is Rona Green here, and I am so honoured and delighted to be invited back to your lovely Eat the Storms Christmas podcast. Thank you so much, Damien, for having me. It's such a thrill and a joy to be here this year. And oh gosh, I'm incredibly excited to be bringing a piece to you that I have actually written myself this time. I can't quite believe it. It has just been the most astonishing and unexpected outcome of this past year. And I'm so grateful to poet Matthew M.C. Smith, editor of Black Bow Poetry, for luring me into this amazing world of writing where I really don't know what I'm doing, but I'm very, very excited by it all and loving every minute of it. And Matt and you, Damien, and Anke, and so many lovely people have been so kind and encouraging to me, and I really, really love you all. I'm overjoyed to read part one of Little Crosses for you now. This is my second piece of writing, and it has its beautiful home in Black Bow Poetry's gorgeous Christmas and Winter Edition Volume 2. Thank you, Damien, for this wonderful opportunity to read with you and all your lovely guests. It's such a privilege. And congratulations on another wonderful year of Eat the Storms. Before I go, my Christmas wish is for blessings to sparkle your way everywhere you go, and for even the darkest corners to be lit. Little Crosses by Rona Green. And we wend our way home, my mother and I, leaving a trail of jingling expectations flashing on and off in our wake, uncontainable simulations of joy in every colour. And we say, that was a good day, wasn't it? And we nod and move on, and I carry the bags of a little this, a little that, and a something extra special for someone, who knows who, just in case we are caught short, and we never are, never will, not while her dear heart is beating still. And on our way we come to the birth, deaths and marriages church on the hill, the one we won't be going to any day soon, and don't expect to again, unless, and we ward off the inevitable with the slick slick brush brush flick flick on off and well simulations. Or joy, or both. I forge on along the beaten track, but she stops for a moment, looks up to the bell tower, holding a wraith of a cloud, passing the moon, slipping through from arc to arc, angel sky tolling silent night, and she listens, spellbound, and I wait. Then she gathers her steps, shuffles on, catches up, and together again, one wise old woman and one fast becoming, linking arms linked to bags full of delicacies, trinkets and charms. And who knows the shape of soul? Maybe the moon, a slipped disc of pearl shine with angels weightlessly falling gracefully, heavenly hosts into that icy chalice of holy, holy night. We glance back but keep on moving, two owls gliding through dark air, hooting hollow hallelujahs, gloria in excelsis deos in the chill. December breeze blows a choir of wraith clouds, and winter freezes still. Then, home trumpets round the corner, hark heralding two off-white faces spearing through the dark, bag-laden wearies swooping in low to roost. I turn the key that opens the door, that cranks the machine, that sets everything twirling to an old familiar tune, and this music box house begins to spin with life as we breathe ourselves deep into all that contains us, and the flick switch lights sparkle everywhere, and even the darkest corners are lit.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, men and women, non-conformers and non-believers, gender accent, gender equals, Sinterklaas, Santa Claus, Père Noël, shining stars and the wise men. We have come to the end of this special Christmas episode of Eat the Storms, the final poetry podcast for 2021. My name is Damien B Donnelly and I would like to say a huge thank you to all of my guests on today's show. Rona Green, Matthew M.C. Smith, Eileen Depuer, M.S. Evans, Sarah Connor, Thomas McCall, Amantine Brodeur, Marion Clark, Paul Adam Short, Jude Marr, Adele Cordner, Wendy Allen, Mairead Carroll and Marcel Newbold and Mark Anthony Owen. As always, for details on all of my guests, please head on over to www.eatthestorms.com, click on the podcast section, and there you will find an episode post for every episode. And in that listing, a photo, bio, and all the social media handles you need to find and follow all of my guests. To you, the listeners, thank you so much for joining me here on Eat the Storms this year. The love and support has poured into me here in Ireland, and I have at times been overwhelmed by your interest and the fact that there are actually people out there listening. In these times of social distancing, there is nothing more comforting in knowing that we can still share our voices and our hearts. And with that said, from me to all of you, I wish you all a safe, warm and wonderful Merry Christmas. And for the new year, may it be so bloody bright. We will see you again with the next episode on the 1st of January, New Year's Day. But until then, and before I leave you with one final unaccompanied tune, make sure that you and your Christmas stays bloody poetic.
Oh, tell it on the mountain, o'er the hills and everywhere. Oh, tell it on the mountain that Jesus is born. Oh, tell it on the mountain, o'er the hills and everywhere. Oh, tell it on the mountain that Jesus is born. Shepherds watching over the flocks by night, and out of the darkness shone heavenly light. They feared and they trembled high above the earth, singing an angel chorus, it was telling of the Savior's birth. Oh, tell it on the mountain, o'er the hills and everywhere. Oh, tell it on the mountain that Jesus is born. Yes, it was a seeker, I saw them both night and day. Ask the Lord to help me, and he showed me the way. Down in a manger where the humble child was born, God sent us salvation, well, on that Christmas morn. And go tell it on the mountain, o'er the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus is born. Now go tell it on the mountain, o'er the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus is born. That Jesus Christ is.